sepulcrului gata, mira la colanciar. Vampira ta, mucu, pompei la mina. Lincana rangan, pim gum honui bursa. Rangan nukna, big yalan bay samgro. Nukmina. If we don't do this, like Blockbuster, we really can go the way that we're going to. And I realize that in this movement, we are all maxed out, right? Like, there's a reason that even I, as an incubator, accelerator, hadn't focused on here, because there's always another crisis. There's always villages or people burning somewhere. And so it's easy to just get so busy with that we don't have time to think strategically about the future. But there will come a time when everybody in this room is not going to be coming to these things anymore. And if we don't replace ourselves, then there isn't going to be anybody to fight those crises. So we need to start thinking about these crises from the framework of youth. How can we engage youth with this particular crisis? How might this crisis be an opportunity to get people excited or motivated or passionate or heartbroken? Sometimes you just have to break people's hearts. To let them know what's going on in the world, to get them motivated to do something about it. So as we're all working in all of the different areas that we're working in, I want to encourage us all to have a youth perspective to think, how can I use what I'm doing right now to attract and engage more youth?
Clearly, in order to achieve our noble and worthy goal of freedom of religion for everyone everywhere on this time, it will take generations. So we need to mobilize not only the mass, but also to retain people and get involved in the effort to do it. There's a standing room here in the CEC. It seems like a lot of young leaders, the youth, the young advocates. The question is, how can we support them? How can we have to sustain that energy and that involvement, that commitment? And the next speaker, Michael Schiffner, he's writing the strategy for search of the ground. And a lot of questions about this that not to be repeated. Thank you. Please, Michael.
All the set up money. I have to say thank you for inviting me. Inviting me to be here. I have to say it's incredibly heartening to come to affect an audience and see that we don't have enough money. Mm-hmm. That's a great thing. People out the store looking in. You know, 10 years ago that wasn't a good thing. 10 years ago there were different kinds of people who were asking the question, well, these are the problems. You know, how do we pacify young people? I work for an organization that is a peace movement. Our focus is on addressing the root causes of violence. We need to take a better from across the bottom line to build a society to that you can see from the movement in Iran, to the movement in Chile, to the youth movement all over the world. You see young people reacting to what's happening, organizing and trying to call it. And our organization is working with the people who can support the alliance and support youth diverse organizations, even NGOs. And we were hearing from young people all over the world clamoring for more space. So actually, it's not a leader. We've got access to so much money and resources going at the conference without access to anything. What kind of resources do you need? As we slowly, slowly, we were able to forge through, you know, simple organizing, whole cross-section of youth-led, youth leaders and youth-led organizations from conference areas all over the world. Finally, coalescing in a conference, maybe the UN conference, international conference, in our mind in 2016. Did anybody go? Did anybody do that? There were well over 1,000 people. Ambassadors, Undersecretary General, the UN, all kinds of people were doing this conference areas, all kinds of people in significant positions. Traditional institutional power. But the agenda setters were not that. The agenda setters were easy. We forged coalition, community, and actually put together what is it that we want to say to people in the position of institutional power? What is it that we actually want to know? And we forged out of that a declaration, and it was one of these processes, the first was called the Amanda Process, which then became the basis of the U.S. Security Council resolution. Which is now known as UN Security Council Resolution 2015. So 2015 summit was modeled off of the famous 1325, which is about women involved in the peace process. 2015 mandated to all member states that they have to create a changing space resources government plan to involve young people directly in building up. It has resulted now in two major things. One is hundreds of millions, if not billions dollars, worth of resources directly going to youth leaders and youth organizations and youth serving projects all over the world. I think one thing that has led to enormous change, actually in the international community, in the international world, about actually accepting and understanding that you guys are partners, you are actually organizing solutions, actually at the forefront of the world. That norm seems like us having standing room in the room. So, in that work, at first, I'm not an expert or have a lot of knowledge in the movement of the work. But I can imagine the moment I've gotten enough. Where you see the fact that you're studying the agenda, speaking actually out about what they are moving to the next generation of freedom. This generation of young people is the largest generation of human beings. 40% of the people living in conflict areas around the world who are suffering from intense violence and repression are youth. And in category of 18 to 25, the huge cohort of people, that's a lot of potential power and national energy. And yet, at least 5% of youth around the world identify in some form or another as a victim. But actually, well under half of young people trust religious institutions.
Ranggang nuk nam dik yang mempai sang troh.